Okay, welcome to Newcastle Borough Council's Cabinet meeting today. Welcome to Cabinet members. We've got five of our Cabinet members today here in the room. Welcome to our officers and also to those councillors that might be watching online and also the public that could be viewing this on YouTube. If you need to see the agenda, there's a link in the section under the YouTube video, which will take you to the council's website and the agenda. Moving to that agenda, our first item is apologies. We've got apologies from Paul Northcott, who is on leave this week. But as I said, all of the Cabinet members are here. That's Jill Waring, Jill Heesam, Trevor Johnson, and Stephen Sweeney. And I'm Simon Tagle, leader of the council. Item two is declarations of interest for any items on the agenda. Do we have any? No, good. Item three is the minutes of the previous meeting, which are on our agenda page 327. Can we agree those are correct record, everybody? Please. Thank you. Item four is Wally's Quarry update report. This is, I think, the third report now we've had since the problems that we've been having with the gas odours at Wally's Quarry. And each time we're progressing the council's position further, this is a full and detailed report which goes into starting with the activity of the council on the odour problems, some of the data we're having, some of the investigations that have taken place, a review of the EA's action since our last meeting, issues to do with health, and then also a number of proposals. But I'm firstly going to hand over to Martin, our Chief Executive, to introduce the item, and then we've got some questions also which have come in from the public, which I'll be relaying to Martin to answer. Thank you, Martin.
Okay, thank you, Chair. As you say, this is the third of the update reports that we've had. Paragraph 2.2 has a table there that shows the complaints that have come in since January to ourselves and to the Environment Agency. And you will see they're updated to a partway through June, but you'll see that the complaint levels are still at quite a considerable level. One of the things that has happened since the last cabinet consideration of this is that Public Health England, who are evaluating the air quality data, have raised concern about the length of time that the problem is persisting and the potential for that to be have a different impact on health. And as a consequence of that, we've moved the multi-agency management of this onto the more formal and, I guess, in many ways, more senior SCG, Strategic Coordinating Group, basis, where range of agencies now at a senior level are around the table using a tried and tested methodology to provide sustained senior input into this issue. That group is now up and running. There are four subgroups that have been established under that SCG. One is regulation and enforcement, which is led by the Environment Agency, and that's looking at all of the regulation regimes that are available and the enforcement activity that's taken. There's a community group which is chaired by myself, and that's looking in particular at preparing an impact assessment so that we can really understand again across agencies what the impact of this is in communities. And that's going to draw quite significantly on the work that's already been provided to the council by the individual impact statements, by various pieces of research that have been undertaken, and of course by the symptom tracker that the county council are now have in place. There's a group called STAC, which is the Scientific Technical Advisory Cell, which brings together the scientists and the medics and the expert on the technical side of this to be looking at data and really understanding what the scientific position is and informing the medical assessments. And then we also have got a comms group. So the report then goes on to pick up the various bits of work that came out of your last meeting. And one of the things you did at the last meeting was receive a proposal from Councillor Huckfield, County Councillor Huckfield, and asked officers to evaluate that. That proposal from Councillor Huckfield follows the strategy, if you like, that has been commended to us by our landfill expert and is also being followed by the Environment Agency, which is around, and it's a phrase you'll probably hear in many of the conversations about this, contain, capture and destroy. So it's about containing the gas within the site by capping, capturing it through the gas management system, and then destroying it through the gas utilization plant. And with the exception of the close the site element of this, what Councillor Huckfield has proposed there is very much consistent with that contain, capture, destroy approach. Colleagues at the Environment Agency have also been provided with that proposal. And they're in particular looking at the issue of the geological fault that that County Councillor Huckfield raised, and we expect to hear back from them in due course about that. There was a request that we work with County Council to get a letter out to residents in affected areas. Rather than a letter, because of the updating of the health advice, there was a multi-agency news release put out that really captured the changed advice and the community engagement. And then events such as last night gave the public engagement event last night gave an opportunity for various partners to set out their work. But I understand consideration is still being given to whether a letter by the two organisations to residents goes ahead. And we also took away an action from the last meeting to look at the implications of providing respite accommodation. And we've worked up a paper on that. You'll see in this paper a suggestion as to how that might work, a scheme that would be open to Newcastle residents. It's difficult to home it in on a particular area because the problems are so widespread. We think we would need to have GPs involved in that, in actually confirming eligibility. Looking at 2-day breaks, one per 6-month period, keeping that respite in Staffordshire, and probably on a 2-3-star basis. So costs of that are quite considerable. And one of the recommendations on the report today is that we do some further work on that and then approach the government about the funding of that initiative. So that's a critical piece there. There was a request as well for health and wellbeing partnership scrutiny to look at the health issues that are arising from the gas odours. And there we've come to an agreement with Staffordshire County Council for a joint exercise to be held in Newcastle. Just finalised details for that. So the County Council have got particular responsibilities regarding health and health scrutiny, as do we. So rather than doing two exercises, we're going to try and more efficiently run that as a joint process. The report then goes on to update in terms of the air quality monitoring that's undertaken jointly by ourselves, the County Council and the Environment Agency. We have the 4 units that are ongoing, and you will see that the site that has been sort of had the highest level of odours above the annoyance guideline has been the Gallengale site. And for the last couple of weeks, that has dipped off a little bit. Now, that may be associated with changes that have been introduced on site in terms of the capture and the capping investments that have been made. But equally, it may be down to seasonal fluctuations. So we really do need to keep a watch and brief on this, you know, intensely watching it to make sure that any reductions in those annoyance levels are actually sustained. Having said that, even though, you know, we're seeing in some cases 1-4% annoyance, that's still a level of exposure that is above that annoyance threshold. We're continuing with our work, currently really going through the collation and the assessment of the evidence that we have collected to to enable us to decide whether or not an abatement notice is necessary and appropriate. And again, you'll see on the face of the report the recommendation that you convene a special meeting later in July to receive that evidence and to make the financial, if appropriate, make the necessary financial commitments to enable an abatement notice to be served, if that is considered to be the appropriate way forward. As previously, there's a summary there of the Environment Agency actions. I won't go through those in detail, but I guess one of the significant ones is an update from the 1st of July, summarising an action plan that's been agreed with the operator to improve gas management and gas collection. You'll remember that I've said in all of these briefings, gas management, gas capture, collection is critical to this. So that will see a further 22 gas collection wells being drilled across the site over the coming months, bringing the total to 77 wells. Now, already the investments we've made have allowed an extra 500 cubic meters an hour of landfill gas to be collected and managed on site. So these extra wells should have a positive impact. And I think that's probably as much as you need to hear from me today.
We'll be answering some questions, Martin, from us in a minute. Thank you anyway. I'd just like to say thank you to our council officers for the work they've been doing since the last cabinet meeting on this, on the abatement notice issue, on all of the other things that are attached to this. It's taken a lot of officer time up at the council, as it should do. It's one of the most important issues affecting our residents. So thank you to Martin and your team, right down to the Environmental Health officers, and plenty more work to do. Just a few points before I bring in some questions that have been sent to me from residents. You say work on the site that's taken place. And of course, am I right in saying that the work is taking place on the site by the operator, Wallace Quarry Limited, formerly Red, and it's been evaluated by them as well, and not by the EA. The EA then obviously received that evaluation of the work from Red. So actually there's nobody from the EA on the site all of the time evaluating, ensuring all these things are happening, which is that correct?
The Environment Agency won't be on site all the time, but they do make visits to the site, both planned visits and unannounced visits.
When they do the full survey to see if there's any gas coming out, that is done by the company, and then that is supplied to the EA, isn't it? It's not done by
the EA. The surface emission survey that you refer to, that's prepared by the company.
Okay, thank you. Looking at what residents are saying, obviously Scott Degg, who's actually somebody that is very active on Twitter and does some very good videos, etc., relating to this. He says an abatement notice can be served by the local authorities as if they are satisfied that a statutory nuisance exists, has occurred, or is likely to reoccur. For the people of Newcastle under Lyme and their health and reputation of the town, please serve the abatement notice. And that's directed at us as a council. So I think you've gave the outline of where we are with that and where we're going with that. And we're having a special cabinet meeting on the 21st where cabinet members will be presented with the evidence. We are not the ones that will then okay the abatement notice, because that's not appropriate that elected members, because I would have put an abatement notice in 3 months ago if I'd have had my say. And of course, that would have been shot down in court immediately, because it would have been political interference. So we have to leave our officers to do that, and they've done that process by investigation, evaluation, and they're moving to the point now where they're likely or unlikely or likely to recommend at the 21st of July whether we press forward. But we would then have to allot the finance to do that, because there is a risk through legal action, which is what we would be embarking on, of a cost to the council if we weren't successful. So that's what that decision will be. But could you just take us through how that process will go forward then, and what the end result is? And I think also to touch on the reoccurring thing. Now, I know you're going to say the end is a fine on the company, isn't it? Is that reoccurring, or is that only a one-off thing? But could you just tell us how we get to there first? Thank you.
Right, okay. So in terms of the in terms of the process, there's a body of evidence that's that's collected, and we've rehearsed it at previous meetings, the sorts of criteria that we need to take into account in reaching a decision as to whether or not a nuisance has occurred. So we will evaluate that evidence, and if there is a case that there is a statutory nuisance and that case can be made, then we would serve an abatement notice on the organisation. At that stage, the organisation has got essentially two choices. It can either accept that abatement notice or it can appeal that abatement notice. If it appeals the abatement notice, then we would go into court, and that's where we would argue the case on behalf of the council, and they would argue their case, and the abatement notice would either be allowed or not. That would then set out, there would then be a raft of activity that would need to take place in order to abate the nuisance, which would be works presumably undertaken by the operator. Now, it's at the point that if an operator were to fail to comply with an abatement notice, there is then the opportunity to enforce on that and secure a fine. And in order to do that, that's the point where we would, before we could actually take, if you like, the enforcement action on for non-compliance with the abatement notice, that's the point where we need to engage with the Secretary of State, because the Environment Agency is the lead regulator, then we would need the Secretary of State's approval to actually progress that.
And he would presumably seek advice from the experts, wouldn't he? In this field would be the EA, I should imagine.
I'm sure the Secretary of State would take advice from a range of officials.
But you wouldn't know who they would be.
I'm sure he would take advice from the Environment Agency, but also from within DEFRA and from within
health,
legal parts of the government, et cetera, et cetera. So there'd be a... I'm sure there'd be a detailed process to that, yeah.
And then
if we were allowed to take that action, you then go into the prosecution for that non-compliance with the abatement notice, which is where we then, if you're successful at that stage, get into the fines.
And the maximum fine is?
Maximum fine is 20,000, I want to say. Yeah, it is, per occasion.
Now, that's a key point, isn't it, which was just out of microphone shot, so people wouldn't have heard. That is per occasion. So in the question from Scott was, is, you know, reoccurring? So, for example, they get hit with the £20,000 fine because they haven't dealt with and the courts say that they haven't dealt with the problem, and that problem continues. Do we hit them with another abatement notice and another abatement notice? How does that work?
Well, the issue is we would have an abatement notice one of the judgments that needs to be arrived at the beginning of this process is it simply a case of abate the nuisance, or is it abate the nuisance and prevent reoccurrence, for example? And so that abatement notice is actually what you would be holding them to account for throughout the process.
And that would be open-ended, would it, I assume, as many times as is necessary?
It will. I think it'll have there'll be a time limit, I guess, on the abatement notice, because you'll be saying you need to have abated the nuisance by.
Right.
Yeah.
Okay. Thank you for that. Another question that's coming from multiple sources is about the respite and the temporary accommodation. And we've covered that. Thank you, Martin, for that. And I think it's just that from my point of view, there is a workable scheme there, but it's unaffordable by a small district council such as Newcastle Borough Council. So I will be writing to the Secretary of State and also copying on our MP, who can lobby on our behalf so we can get that funding. One of the questions is about the medical evidence that's now floating around on social media from doctors who and paediatricians, etc. say, on the impact and the length and on the quality of life and also the health of people. You know, is the council aware of all of those? Are officers tying those into to the evidence which we are using not only for this, but when we think about respite and temporary accommodation?
We are we're aware of various various reports that are around. I don't think we'll get anybody at the table today who's medically qualified to comment on them. But certainly through that SCG process, those are being looked at by the stack, who, where you've got properly qualified and experienced people who can evaluate that and see what that adds to the overall picture.
Okay, and then two questions about monitoring. Dr. Mixalt has requested that the environmental health team advise when the report about the mobile hydrogen sulfide monitoring will be available for scrutiny, particularly that from in actual homes. I'm going to be writing back with the answer to that, which you've given me, but I'd like you to give that answer now publicly.
Okay, thanks. Yeah, I mean, the information that we collected using the handheld Jerome's in individual people's houses was collected expressly as part of the process of establishing whether or not there's a statutory nuisance that's occurring here. So we are looking at what of that information can be released ahead of concluding our position regarding statutory nuisance without risking any compromise to that if the decision was to issue statutory nuisance or abatement notice. So one of the things we don't want to do is be in a position where we, if you like, rush to publish and in so doing compromise any action that the council might take. So what I would advise to Dr. Salt is if he puts in a formal environmental information regulation request to us, we'll evaluate that when we know precisely what it is that he wants. We'll evaluate it in the context of what we're doing, and we'll either be able to say yes or no.
Okay, thank you. I completely agree with what you said there, and I will pass on that information to Dr. Salt. Last question before I open it up for cabinet members is from Mark Warren, who I know lives very close to this site and has suffered a lot of problems. He's saying, has anyone ever measured sulfur dioxide in homes polluted by the landfill? Hydrogen sulfide changes to this and is also very toxic. Marty.
Should have brought a stack along today. Right. So the some of the four air quality monitoring stations that are obviously collecting information outside also have got the ability to collect sulfur dioxide added into them. So three of those will have it. I think at the moment there's at least one of them that is actually live with collecting that data. So that information will be available and provided to Public Health England to enable them to evaluate. From a very quick look at this, the conversion rate from hydrogen sulfide to sulfur dioxide appears to be a one-to-one relationship. So they'll be able to work out, even without collecting that information, be able to work out what the hydrogen sulfide levels are. The work that we've done within homes has monitored hydrogen sulfide, not sulfur dioxide.
Okay, thank you for that. And obviously, we asked you those questions, so we didn't think you had enough questions to the SCG last night, Martin. That's a little bit of a joke there. But I think I welcome that SCG process coming forward. It's always a lot better to have people actually being seen on video rather than on a blind telephone call, which was what the EA were doing previously. So I think that's a good progression. Hopefully, that will become a good way of communicating from all the partners, health, the Borough Council, EA, the fire service that chair it. Thank you to Rob Barber for chairing that last night. I think it was very good. Just to, before I bring in Stephen, I think on the ongoing stink, I think anybody that's been in and around the town centre the last couple of days, this week. I smelt it when I came into the offices earlier. It seems to be hitting the eastern side, Crosseath, Maybank last night and this morning, Portill, Bradwell, because of the wind direction. So I think people on the other side of the borough had a little bit of respite from it, but no doubt when the wind changes, it will come around and affect those houses that are right near to the quarry. So this is far from over. And I think I would encourage people to continue to report them to either the Borough Council or the Environment Agency or both, to keep those reporting numbers up. When you do smell it, give what you think on the scale the odour is. And we keep the pressure on this, particularly on, as I always say in these meetings, the regulator of the site is the Environment Agency. It is their role to act on this. Bring in Steve.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Leader. No, just a couple of things. I was driving down Clayton Bank today, quite halfway down, and I hit the smell then, halfway down there. On page 11, Martin, you got the complaints received, and it says something about June was only a part of June or something. How big a part of June?
I'll look to the author. Thanks, Chair. I think we're probably just missing the last week, so it's the majority, probably three quarters of June.
Okay. The other thing is on 3.2. When I first read this, I thought, it's come down quite a lot. But when you sort of actually read the script on 3.2 as opposed to just the figures, you realise, of course, this isn't saying the smell's only there for 2% of the time. The smell could be there 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. It's just for 2% of the time. It's above the World Health Organization's odour annoyance. So it's still there. It's just not annoying you. So it's when I first read it, I thought, it isn't bad. It's still there. It's just 2% of the time. Alarm bells to the World Health Organization.
That's actually a really important distinction. Yeah. We are, this is saying that's the percentage of time that it's above the annoyance level. One of the things that we do know is noses are incredibly sensitive to this. Most noses are incredibly sensitive to this. And so people will smell it below that annoyance level.
I just thought that was worth pointing out, because when I first read it, you have to sort of read it. Yes, of course, yes. No, that's it. Thank you, Tom.
Just on that monitoring data, I think, as I just said, obviously the eastern side, because of the wind direction during the summer, if we can call it a summer, with all the rain we've just had, brings it directly over the monitoring equipment that's been there for a long time and was there previously when the EA did some monitoring by the pump station in Silverdale. Everybody, including our officers, the EA will accept that that is not the most ideal site for that, being on one side of it a big pumping station for Severn Trent, on the other side a row of houses, and the wind, the air directions are not the same. And I believe, my own personal opinion, is that this odour goes above and over there and up the hill and straight into Nutton, Crosseath, Fulstanton, Maybank, Portill, as we've seen in the last few days. So that's just my personal view, but that's based on also the fact that equipment is universally seen to be in the wrong place. Trevor.
Thank you, Leader. The only comment I've got is that, you know, 20 grand fine is nothing to a company like this. You know, it's not a deterrent. That is just an observation.
Marty.
It's an observation. I think, you know, one of the things that we talked about certainly at your last meeting, and I would make the case again today, is it would be exceptionally useful if Wally's Quarry would just acknowledge fully that this is an issue coming from their premises, and you know, take on that responsibility of sorting it without the need to be expending resources on the enforcement regime.
Yeah, I think what we've seen, that they're not prepared to do that, because their response to our letter was to send in a report which tried to say that the odours and gas smells weren't coming from their site at all, and it would come from an external site. Which they've paid consultants to give them that report. So I'm really pleased to see in the report and in the recommendations, we are saying that basically isn't good enough, and we're not being deflected by that. And I think that's something which the public should see, read and understand, that we are not going to be deflected from this by the smoke and mirrors and stink of the company. Jill.
Yeah, thank you, Leah. I'd just like to thank Martin for all that information. There is a lot and it's very technical. And in respect to how far that smell travels, I probably live as far away from it as in the borough as you can possibly be. It's about 8 or 9 miles. I've got a keen sense of smell, and that smell is unmistakable, and I can smell it where I live, you know, quite a lot more recently than before. So at one time I used to think, was it, you know, I live in a rural area with farmers' fields, could it be what's on the farmers' fields? But it's definitely that smell. It's unmistakable. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill. And that just indicates, you know, that in that direction, and also in the direction of Trentham and Hanford, Trent Vale, these are, you know, 5-6 miles away where people are experiencing, you're the same in the other direction. Just bringing Jill, who's obviously a Westlands councillor and having a bit of respite at the moment, the Westlands is, because of the wind direction, but it could turn around very quickly. Jill.
Yeah, I mean, I don't think it's going to go away anytime soon, which is why it's quite lucky. Oh, good that we're looking at this. I wouldn't say lucky. But I do have quite a lot of people complaining to me about it, most particularly in the local pub. I don't know whether it's because I'm just a sitting target when I go in there. But it is. It's a huge problem, particularly at night for some reason. I don't know what they do at night. And it's good that we're looking at this.
And the other side of it is of course, the health issues, which if anybody who tuned into the SCG last night would have seen, you know, the PHE and the other, you know, health officials on there have got concerns about how long this has been going on. And they're upgrading it in their mind that this, you know, short-term health issues over that longer period. I mean, short-term health issues are never acceptable anyway and shouldn't be. How we got to that stage, I don't know. But this has been going on for a long time, and we really have to ensure that this, you know, this company is held to account, and the AO held to hand to the fire to ensure the company is held to account. So unless there's any more speakers, I will obviously again thank Martin for taking the 20 questions, so to speak, from us today and from the public. They are now obviously available to view online forever. But the recommendations before us are that we obviously note the response has been received from the company to the letter before action, and that officers, in their view, is not sufficient to address the concerns raised. And note that despite the work that has been taken by Wallace Corrie Landfill after the EA's request, of course, a significant level of complaints continue to be received from residents of the borough, and our monitoring new data continues to show odour levels and exceedance of the noise levels. And we can add to that now that we're stinking it. If we were to go outside this building and walk across the road towards the gym, we would all smell it, of a three, possibly a four, earlier on. Four, we agree to hold a special cabinet meeting on the 21st of July 2021 to carefully consider all of the evidence collated to date and receive advice on whether or not the abatement notice should be served, and consider the financial implications of this. And our decision will be on the financial implications of this, and officers will then go ahead with legal advice on that, whether to serve that notice. Four, that we progress the next steps of developing a temporary respite accommodation scheme, including requesting financial support for the scheme from the government. I'll be doing that as soon as possible, because I know there's a lot of public concern about that being ramped up by evidence being put forward by clinical professionals. Five, that the formation of the SCG that the council is involved in, we'll continue to work with them on a multi-agency basis in order to investigate and resolve the issues. And then, of course, we have a full council on the evening of the 27th of January, and we will be putting a report into that so all councillors can have their say and on the update that we give them from the report which Martin and his officers will provide. So those six recommendations before us, do we all agree? Thank you very much. And of course, we will continue to have reports to Cabinet on this as long as we need to. And I hope for the day when we don't have to have reports to Cabinet on this, and we can get back to some normality, and also people can get back to some normality in their lives, not to have this hanging over them going forward. Okay, our next item on the agenda is item five, provisional financial outturn 2020-21. Over to Stephen Sweeney, our portfolio for finance.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Leader. The draft statement of accounts for 2021 will be presented to the Audit and Standards Committee for approval on the 26th of July 2021. Obviously, the COVID pandemic has had a significant impact on the Council's financial position through a mixture of lost income and additional costs. So income losses and additional costs amount to something like £4.940 million. a shade under £5 million. Despite these considerable pressures, I'm pleased to report an outturn for 2021 of a favourable variance of £5,000 against the budget that was set. Now, you might think I'm a miracle worker. I have healing hands. But no, we have a government, a council, a local authority, an MP who actually listen to our concerns, and I would imagine every other council's concerns, to be honest with you, to say that we were going to run out of money. The net result of that is the government, in various different grants and forms, gave us £5.070 million, which, you know, is a little bit more than it's actually cost us. The net effect of that is we've got a revenue budget's all of £5,000 out, down to that money. This time last year, I think we were all fairly stressed as to where on earth the money was coming from. Well, the government have done what they said they've done and supplied councils with the resources to continue, and I thank them for that. And we had the minister was here on Friday, and I thanked him in person. Obviously, expenditure has also been reduced because we could see this coming. I think you'd be fairly stupid if you hadn't. And managed to ensure that only absolutely necessary spending has been incurred. This has helped to reduce the adverse variance on a service-by-service basis. Following a vigorous risk assessment in response to COVID-19 and as part of the Council's strategy to increase financial resilience, the general fund balance held in reserve has been increased from £1.448 million to £3 million, which is something that I think we need to do. Puts us in a much safer place should any risks to its finances materialise. It's also something I believe that the auditors are very, very keen on us having. And I know the 151 officer is very anxious that our reserves build up to a certain extent. Planned expenditure via capital, we've managed to be £1,000 out on a budget. Actually, I've spent by £1,000 to put the two figures together. It's actually £4,000 underspent. £1,000 overspent, which I think is a phenomenal achievement. And I totally commend these accounts. I think it's we've worked hard with the government, we've heard a lot with our officers, and the results that we've got in front of us are proof of the pudding, and I'm very happy to commend them to you. Thank you, Sam.
Thank you, Steve. Endorse what you said there about that. I think it's been a very, very difficult period. But through the way this council has worked for its community, delivered all of those services continually for the community throughout it, all the homelessness services, the services of our street scene teams and our recyclers to keep services going and waste collections throughout this period. And the government, you know, we've had many conversations with our MP. Our MP has had many conversations with government ministers. Robert Jemery, because you said Steve visited Newcastle on Friday to look at some of the work we're doing on Future High Streets Fund and Town Deal. And personally, we need to thank him as well for his delivering for local government on this. And, a lot of councils would be in a lot worse state if it wasn't for that funding coming in, because we now, as we emerge from lockdown and services are beginning to open up again, we're on an even keel rather than trying to catch up from a year of lost income. So I think it's really important that they did that, and that's justified in the figures we've got here. That leaves us in good stead when we start to set our budget for the next year coming forward. Open it up to any other comments from Cabinet members? No? Okay, so recommendations before us is the Provisional General Fund outturn and key issues in respect to the Council financial position be noted. All agreed? Thank you. Next item is item number four, which is the Housing Strategy 2021-25. Jill Heeson, portfolio holder, is going to introduce this. Over to you, Jill.
Okay. Right. The report relates to approving the text of our Housing Strategy 2021-25 to allow it to go out to public consultation. The current housing strategy was adopted in 2016 for 5 years. It's considered an appropriate time to review that and refresh the housing strategy to evaluate the current issues and to formulate strategic priorities. Housing is fundamental to so many aspects of our lives and the issues currently facing the borough, as well as those expected to occur over the next few years. It sets out our strategic housing priorities and details a range of actions the council intends to take in partnership with relevant partners and stakeholders to support residents to access good quality, suitable and affordable housing, and seeking to prevent homelessness and rough sleeping. Three key priorities have been identified, and that's housing, health, wellbeing and partnerships, which includes private rented sectors, conditions, disability adaptations, energy efficiency and supported accommodation, housing and economic recovery, which links into the local plan and regeneration of the town relating to housing supply and affordability, homelessness and rough sleeping, which includes homelessness advice, prevention and support activities, housing allocations and temporary accommodation options. It's proposed to consult on these for an 8-week period, followed by analysis of all comments to understand residents' and partners' views in greater detail. And I would ask that the Cabinet approves the recommendations.
Thank you, Jill. That's great. I have no problem in endorsing that. And I think it's the council does a good job on its housing strategy. And as we've seen through the low figures of homeless and then how we deal with them and get them into accommodation, I think that is top quality and there's real good value for money. I think there is the other issue of obviously the rough sitters, as we call them. These are the ones that are not homeless, but come into our town and sit around and cause antisocial behaviour and drug and alcohol issues. And the Cabinet have decided to call a summit of relevant parties on that, including the local refuge housing providers, also the police, and also community safety team and housing teams to look into that. Because one of the biggest complaints I get from residents is of all these homeless in the town centre. Well, fortunately, they're not homeless. They are actually do have accommodation and they come out of that accommodation into the day and sit around and cause antisocial behaviour in the town centre. There's a lot of issues why they do that. There's a lot of issues with mental health and other things. It's not necessarily always their fault, of course. But also there is an issue of the effect on our town centre and our businesses and the general feel of our town centre. So we're going to get the relevant partners together to see if there's a way forward of reducing that. And that's something which we'll report back to Cabinet and the public at a future date. But open this up to any comments on the report before us. Jill?
Really, just pleased to see that the strategy is being updated. I do think it's one of the most important areas of responsibility for the Borough Council. I'm glad to see that there's strong emphasis on partnership working and look forward to seeing the results of the public consultation. Thank you.
Thank you, Jill. So recommendations before us there as Jill Heaston has moved, all agreed? And then moving on to item 7, which is a sister paper, really, of this in Jill's portfolio, future provision for temporary accommodation. Jill.
It links in really with the one before, or it will do in 4 years' time. Okay, the Cabinet report seeks to pick up where the earlier temporary accommodation policy report from December 2020 left off. In particular, the report is seeking to outline the progress made with the development of a range of temporary accommodation ideas, proposals and options for homeless applicants and individuals identified as rough sleepers with complex needs. And it's fair to say very limited options in the borough at the moment. It's seeking approval from the Cabinet for us to develop these proposals further for delivery with our specialist partners expeditiously to make use of time-limited funding opportunities as they present to us. More specifically, to enable us to make direct contact awards for provision with suitably experienced providers within the borough without a call for further competition or use of a compliant framework. Based on officer engagement to date and the limited supplier market responses previously received. It's recommending that approval is given to enable direct awards via delegated authority to the portfolio holder and the Director of Economic Development and Commercial Growth, subject to the available council budget or additional external funding sourced achieved by officers. We're looking at specifically here the planned development of temporary accommodation and support services as outlined in the report to ensure that there is appropriate availability of temporary accommodation in the borough. As I say, I'm asking that the Cabinet approves the recommendations.
Thank you, Jill. Again, support you on this. And I think it's a crucial service that the council provides for people that are sometimes, for whatever reasons, you know, have to leave the home they've had and require temporary accommodation, or else they're on the streets, which of course we can't, we don't want to see in our borough. I think in the past, temporary accommodation, and still at this time, is too far away from where they probably originate, outside of Newcastle. So I think we're right to look for temporary accommodation opportunities within the borough. And this might only be for a couple of nights or a few nights. It's not when we're talking about the rough sitters, as we just were, some of those are permanently in refuges, etc., in the town. These are other types of people as well, which need our help immediately. And this future provision of temporary accommodation will help us to achieve that. Open it up to any comments, Jill?
Yeah, thank you, Leader. I endorse this report. In order to provide temporary accommodation, I think if it's flexibility that the officers need, along with the authority to be able to respond rapidly, then you know, I think they should have it, and that way we can provide the best possible service we can for those finding themselves in the distressing situation of having no roof over the head. And I think if it's what we need to do, we need to do, and I fully support it. Thank you.
Okay, so recommendation before us that Jill has moved, all agreed? Thank you. Next item is our item number 8, which is our urban tree planting strategy. Over to Trevor Johnson.
Thank you, Leader. The Council adopted its sustainable environment strategy in December last year, which commits to an undertaking a feasibility study for a tree planting programme to facilitate carbon capture and greening. This urban tree planting strategy is a plan for planting trees in the urban areas of the borough, which brings that commitment to life in more ways than one. It is intended that the strategy focuses on the urban wards in the borough. An initial site on Sandy Lane, Newcastle, has already been planted with trees as a pilot site as part of an initiative in partnership with the Japanese Embassy, who donated cherry trees for the site. Ward members in the urban wards of the borough will be invited to propose areas of borough council-owned open space in their wards for planting, and for each site that is considered suitable for planting, consultation will take place with residents. Although the main focus of the planting will be on land that is owned by the borough council, it does not preclude opportunities to work with other landowners, particularly where there is land in other ownerships that lies adjacent to borough council land. And it is proposed to work closely with organisations, including Staffordshire County Council and Aspire, who have their own sustainability commitments. Thank you, Leader.
Thank you, Trevor. Completely endorse what you said there. And this is a great policy. And we've made a small start, haven't we, in Sandy Lane, with the opportunity that arose from the Japanese Embassy trees. And I think recommendations are great. I'd just like to add something to it. Of course, we've got a big event next year called the Queen's Platinum Jubilee, which all the Lord Lieutenants across the county are formulating as part of the Queen's Jubilee canopy tree planting across the county. So I would like to add an extra recommendation, if Cabinet will indulge me, that we obviously investigate the opportunities for taking part in the Queen's Jubilee canopy for tree planting, and some of the sites that were brought forward by councillors in as part of this urban tree planting strategy, I should say councillors and the community, bring forward by the community as well, could be used for planting some of those trees, which will be part of that celebration for the Queen's Platinum Jubilee. So if people will support me on that, that'd be great. Steve?
Just a comment, really. I just went up to Old Stanton before I came here and drove past the Sand Lane, which I'm not seeing for a few months because it's not a road I've really gone. And how nice it is. Oh, that looks really, really nice. Yes, long way to continue. That's awesome.
And Steve, just the opportunity to do that in other parts of the borough, isn't it? And of course, as part of this, as it does say in the report or in the strategy, you know, part of this is for our carbon offset to reduce our carbon emissions, which will come in use as the trees grow older, the more they reduce the carbon for us. So I completely endorse this way forward, part of our sustainable environment strategy, Trevor, as you say. So recommendations before with 5 added that we get in there with the Queen's Jubilee canopy preparations, and planting will start in October for them, for the October to March planting season. So there's out of the traps very quickly, but we must indicate to the Lord Lieutenant's office and others that are involved in this that we want to put some land forward. But before we move to the vote, Jill, you want to come in?
Yeah, it's just a quick question. If there's any local community groups that want to become involved in this, who did they approach?
they can get an email to me and then we'll see where we go from there. Okay.
Thank you, Trevor. So recommendations before us with the added one about the Queen's Jubilee canopy. All agreed? Thank you. Next item in the same vein, in the same portfolio, is encouraging greater use of our parks and open spaces. And Trevor's leading on this one too.
I won't go into a great long diatribe on this one, just to report the Parks and Open Spaces Working Group. And I'll just add that I hope we're going to have some schemes such as Jill's Pump Park throughout the borough as we really enhance our green spaces. Thank you, Leader.
Yes, we've all seen the facility up there in Kidsgrove, haven't we? And we want more of those across the borough. People have already said, what about my area? So we're already looking into funding on some. We won't give anything away because we won't get people's hopes up, but we are looking at funding opportunities to do more of that type of stuff, which is really good. But I think this is really great that's come from scrutiny and from a working party. Often people say, oh, what does scrutiny do? Blah, blah, blah. But this is a working group and gone back to the full committee and had their endorsement. So I endorse this report. And any more comments? No? Okay, so we'll put that on our books. Thank you for that. So all agreed? Thank you. Next item, item 10, is Jubilee 2, improvement of the health and fitness offer at J2. And Jill Waring, our portfolio holder, is introducing this.
Thank you, Leader. Yes, Jubilee 2, improvements to the health and fitness offer. This report refers specifically to the fitness suite, which has 100 pieces of equipment. This is the original equipment installed in 2011. It's now 8 years old, and in terms of this type of equipment, is reaching the end of its life. It often breaks down. We can't get the parts, so we can't get it repaired. And then all of this takes away from the customer experience. And this in itself creates the impression that places run down, and it's a situation that's not befitting the high-end aspirations of J2 that we have. The use of gyms is still one of the most popular leisure activities in the borough, and we need to bring this equipment up to date in order to provide our customers with a modern quality fitness suite. We will, with the new equipment, be able to offer four different areas in the gym, providing different types of exercise and allowing for small group exercises. The suite will be redecorated and minor improvements will be made, including the installation of digital equipment. We are looking to engage the leisure specialists, Alliance Leisure, to oversee the procurement process with a target date of completion of December 2021. And this is something that we originally were intending to do last year, but it didn't happen. So the benefits of this are listed in paragraph 2.3 of the report. This is a tried and tested method of procurement. We used it for the pump track at New Chapel Recreation Ground, and it goes beyond just buying pieces of equipment. The project is not just about swapping equipment. There's a lot of different work that needs to be done, and it's not about bog standard cheapest equipment. We are looking at the top end, high quality installation and the best that we can provide for our J2 customers. We will be getting the best advice from leisure specialists and the best value equipment and the best value for money. And I believe that this is the best way forward for the refurbishment of the fitness suite at J2 and will provide our customers with a more diverse offer. It will improve member satisfaction and utilise the floor space to its maximum potential and provide a commercial opportunity to increase membership, uptake and retention going forward. At this point, I would just like to ask our Executive Director, Commercial Development and Economic Growth, Simon McEnany, if he could just please confirm that the cost of this work is included in the original contract with Alliance Leisure, please.
Thanks, Jill. The contract we have with Alliance Leisure is around marketing of the centre and pushing up membership numbers and advice on how we take that forward, and they worked up this scheme with the team at J2, and it'll be part of their remit that they'll help us through this contract, yes, as part of the contract we have with them at the moment.
Steve?
Yeah, Nigel, put a summary, there's a £79,000 charge on here, sir.
there is a charge that is part of, it's a fee that we have to access when we access all framework agreements, as we have done at Kids Grove and we will be doing at the demolition of the Civic Centre. If you access a framework agreement, there is a fee chargeable, and some of that is, you get additional support, but it's not, it's a regular thing in these types of procurement.
So it's the money goes to Alliance Leisure?
I'd have to check where
it says on here it is.
Right. It's the Alliance Leisure framework. So whether it goes to part to them or part to the subcontractors that they apply, I'd have to check and get back to you.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Simon. Thank you, Stephen. I would therefore now like to amend the recommendation as follows, and that would be to bring a report back to Cabinet when Alliance Leisure have given their recommendation on what it is that we require. Thank you.
Amending recommendation one. Yeah. Or is it amending recommendation two? Recommendation one stays the same. Sorry, yeah. So that comes in. So basically, no delegated authority comes back to Cabinet for us to have a look what Alliance Leisure recommended, scrutinise, and then go off for a decision if we're happy with it. Okay. All agreed? Okay, thank you for that. Before we go, I was meaning to ask a question, Jill. Obviously, on J2, we obviously know membership was decimated because of J2, because of COVID and the close down. Could you just give us information on how we're building back that membership up again and where we are from where we were?
Thank you, Leader. I don't have the exact sticks in front of me. Yeah, Alliance Leisure are working well with the team there, and we are doing some exciting things to promote membership. There's going to be like fitness swims and that type of thing. They've helped with training of the staff, and all looks good going forward. I think we're in a good position at the moment. Yeah, it's around about 2,000 at the moment and going up as we speak.
Previously, it was about 2,900 before the pandemic, wasn't it? And if I'm right, do Alliance Leisure don't get any sort of supplements or whatever until after they get above 3,000. Was it 3,500?
I think that's correct.
Simon.
That was the original agreement before the pandemic, where there was an agreement that after 3,000 memberships were achieved, there was a cost share or a cost benefit, and we wouldn't pay them anything until they got to 3. The fact that then memberships then went down to sub 1,600, we're now paying them a monthly fee for marketing. So they're being paid for direct marketing and advice and for social media and stuff like that. And we agreed that earlier in the year, I think, and it's a 12-month fee for that, but it's already shown benefit, because in the last 3 months, as Jill has indicated, the memberships have gone above 2,000. We've been seeing 100 new memberships every month on the back of that effort that Alliance Leisure have given, but also they're retraining the staff and have been helpful in dealing with the online classes that we did throughout the pandemic, etc. So they've not just sat there and taken the fee, they've helped build the brand of activity through the pandemic, and are continuing that work with the team for the next couple of months.
That's great, thank you for that update. Thank you, Jill.
I just wanted to add that from my experience with Alliance Leisure, they're always coming up with new initiatives. There's always something new coming through to look at and promote J2 as a whole. Thank you.
Thank you for that. Okay, going back to our agenda, item 11 is our forward plan, obviously attached at the end, whatever page you come under. Page 78, 79 is the first page. Which has got details of cabinet meetings through to September. And then on the other page is the full September through to October. So we've got some good business coming up there, advancing our joint local plan. What am I talking about? Our borough local plan. And also moving forward on the finances, setting the medium-term financial plan, etc. So can we all agree those forward plans? Yeah. Brilliant. Okay. Item 12 is urgent business. I don't have any urgent business. Item 13 is disclosure of exempt information. We don't have any, so there's no need to go into confidential. I haven't received any public questions or anything from councillors to attend this meeting. So just before I close the meeting, this is just what we're in at the moment today, is with all the other problems we've been having, we can put them aside for a few hours this evening and not all of us probably, but most of us will be supporting England tonight, and good luck to them. And hope they put a smile on everybody's face later. And I'm sure everybody will be watching. I certainly will. But thank you for everybody attending Cabinet today, and also to those that have been watching online, and I call this meeting to a close. Thank you.